Professor, what makes the latest altercation different from the others?
Well, of course, the information is limited at this time, no? But it appears that this altercation was a little bit more aggressive on the Chinese side, as stated by the NTFWPS in its press release, no? There's an incident, not only dangerous maneuvers, but also of ramming and towing. So this this is far more serious, I think, no? Just the mention of the fact that there was an attempt to tow the vessel, I think that's a new escalation on the part of China.
Okay, now where does this put the situation in the West Philippine Sea, considering the Chinese Coast Guard? It recently released a statement, and it claims the Philippines violated the international regulations for preventing collisions at sea and deliberately approached the Chinese ship in an unprofessional manner, causing a collision. So we have here a situation where China is pushing its own set of rules, right, that they said would be implementable by June 15. But those are not international rules of the sea. So where does this put the Philippines and, in a way, also the situation in the West Philippine Sea, in the South China Sea, if China is practicing its own set of rules?
Well, first of all, no, with respect to the Chinese description of what happened, we know that that has very little, if not zero, credibility, because usually these collision situations are created by them. They put themselves right in front of our ships. So mm-hmm. if a collision actually took place, it's actually due to their having created that situation. Now, with respect to the overall situation in the, on the ground with this imposition of rules, what it implies is that China is trying to place the Philippines, a sovereign nation, under its laws and regulations. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it is an act of subordination, basically, of the Philippines, generally. So we might as well be a province of China if that were the case. No? So that's why this is not acceptable.
Okay. Now, Professor, China's been quite consistent. We know this. In all our interviews, they're quite predictable. They don't change their tactics. They're doing already what's predicted. The question is, what can we do?
Well, I think we have to be thinking out of the box because, as you mentioned, China has a particular strategy which is intended to result in depriving the Philippines of the West Philippine Sea, and that any access to the West Philippine Sea by the Philippines will have to be by the permission of China and on China's terms. You'll notice that in their latest demand that the Philippines should give notice or seek permission, rather, for Philippine units to resupply at the BRP Sierra Madre. That in itself is indicative of what they want, which is for us to essentially give up our rights and entitlements to the West Philippine Sea. Now, of course, number one, we cannot accept this. So we should never acknowledge or even accept a situation where we have to get their permission to be doing anything. Otherwise, our fishermen will have to get their permits from Beijing, probably, not fishing permits and all of that. No? Mm-hmm. And our businessmen, our merchant fleet, they would have to get permission from Beijing every time we need to go to anywhere in Asia. Even our aircraft will have to ask that permission if that were to be the case. No? So I think that the only situation or the only thing we can do at this time is really to resist that, no, legally and formally, and in the meantime insist on our rights to freely access our own waters. No? Mm-mm. Mm-mm. Now China will continue to try to interfere with all of our activities, and that will probably end up costing them a lot more. No, I doubt whether they can sustain an operation which tries to intercept each and every Philippine vessel and interfere each and every Philippine activity in the West Philippine Sea. No? So, and in the meantime as well, we need to strengthen our alliances and partnerships with other countries so that they can also mobilize international pressure and support, no, against these intrusions of China and their attempts to subordinate us, to subjugate us, basically, in the West Philippine Sea.
Okay. Now, the Chinese Coast Guard says it took control measures against the Philippine vessels. So I believe there were two Philippine vessels and two speedboats. Do we have the same information, or it's one supply ship and two speedboats?
Well, actually, there's no confirmed information really on the the participating vessels, but yes, I got similar information about that. And sometimes you can just infer it from from correlating the statements of the two sides. So
Okay. Did you get
let's
any
assume that that's what
information
happened.
also on any bodily injury? Because there are
Well,
some articles about that, but it's
yeah.
not quite clear.
Yes, I read one article confirming supposedly one person being severely injured. But again, this is from another source, so it's very hard to make assumptions, no? So maybe we can just use that as just take it as given at this point, no? Until we get otherwise.
Okay, now the U.S. ambassador has actually issued a statement, and it came out on X, and it's already called China's latest moves as dangerous, right? And you've had other countries already say this. You also have concerns coming from G7 members from the United States, Italy, Britain, France, Germany, Japan, and Canada. All concerned about China's maneuvers in the West Philippine Sea. But Professor Batong Bakal, I've always reiterated this. And then what? Because it's already been years, which is good that these foreign countries have issued concerns. But and then what? You have said earlier you don't know if China can sustain it. What if I say, what if they can? So what happens?
Well, what will happen essentially is that if China has the forces to kick us out of the West Philippine Sea, no, they will probably do it. Okay? They've
Well,
made
the
their
word
intentions
isn't
very
probably
clear.
kick out, but then every day make it much more difficult because this is a country that's already, I mean, from reefs within the exclusive economic zone, have built structures where planes can land and take off. So my question is, what makes us think this is not sustainable for China?
No,
They
I
can
think
keep doing this for many years.
yes, and they will keep on doing it. I think I also mentioned it in quite a number of other talks in many places. No, their intention really is to dominate, no, the South China Sea for their own security purposes, not even for resource related issues, because that is clearly secondary to them. And they do not care whether this results in depriving the Philippines and other surrounding countries, no? If it results in the absence of their food security or environmental security. I mean, that much is clear. They demonstrated that by building these artificial islands, no? So that is the kind of future we're looking at. We are looking at a South China Sea dominated by China, and the Philippines being unable to do anything in it without China's permission or tolerance at the very least. And that to me is an unacceptable situation, because that means we will be subordinating ourselves to this regional superpower. Now, what comes next? Unfortunately, I think it will get a lot worse before it gets better. And the key here is that China is confident in its power, and it believes that the Philippines is the one to surrender. It will be the one to blink first here, and it believes that because it sees us as the weaker state here, the weaker party. And in many respects, that's true, because by economy and military power alone, China is already 10 to 15 times larger than ours. So our only chance, really, in this for the long term is to strengthen even more our alliances, partnerships, and friendships with other nations. Now, within the region, that is a lot more difficult, because we have some countries within ASEAN, for example, that are, irretrievably connected with China. On the other hand, there are those who are seeking another path. Those we might need to cultivate even more, no? Even if that will be difficult. But I think they would also see the importance of not falling under China's orbit. And then for the external countries, that's where our strengths will lie, because our people, we're a world people, actually, we have people everywhere in the world. And I think that is an important foundation for us to be able to build up and cultivate these friendships and alliances, not only militarily, but also economically. And that, I think, is probably what's going to give us the most leverage
If
we continue to build up, those economic linkages, then I think we can translate that into political leverage so that we can make up for our lack in size through the ability to leverage other nations' influence.
Okay, but this is there a way to use the Mutual Defense Treaty where it doesn't actually signify that it's going to be used for war? But is there a way to use the Mutual Defense Treaty in terms of mutual cooperation or in terms of sowing peace within the West Philippine Sea, for example?
Yes, actually, most people think that the MDT is only for purposes of war, but actually, when you look at the various provisions of the MDT, it also includes all other cooperative efforts less than that. No, so these are often overlooked. No? So the Mutual Defense Treaty can also be useful for improving our security relations, as it has been used, no, through these EDCA and these Balikatan exercises. We're really building up our external defense capability. But that can also lead to us to other improvements, no, in our external and security capabilities, no? So like even in our internal waters, in our archipelagic waters, which will be useful as well. We have also been using this security relationship in, I think, a little bit a little bit better now, because we have been leveraging it to also get more economic investments from the US, no? Very important ones, like in electronics and things like that. So we need to keep pushing those things. And also, other countries like Australia and Japan are coming to the Philippines because of our alliance with the United States, and also looking at engaging in their own security relationships with us. So I think that's how this is playing out now. It's going beyond just MDT Philippine-US relations and Philippine-US collective defense. It's actually now becoming the foundation for a much broader security architecture.
Yeah, but then let's get more immediate, no? I mean, China just enforced the no, their no trespassing, their no trespassing rule, and this takes effect on June 15. So, under the no trespassing rule, China can actually detain foreigners accused of illegally entering Chinese waters up to 60 days without trial. So let's talk about something that could happen in the West Philippine Sea. Since China believes that they can implement this rule, let's say there's a Filipino fisherman within our exclusive economic zone, right? Another altercation happens. They actually pick up Filipino fishermen, Filipino citizens, detain them for 60 years. 60 days. Where does that leave us? What does the Philippines do? Because at
Well,
the
it
end, yeah, the issue is really on the ground. What can we do to let China know their rules don't exist globally?
Well, number one, no, because it is without any kind of credible legal basis, no. Trying to arrest our fishermen in the West Philippine Sea, no, would be tantamount to hostage taking, no, and kidnapping and hostage taking, because it is really is without legal basis. And even this arbitrary 60-day detention, no, without charges, flies in the face of international human rights. So the Philippines, number one, can do what it needs to do to prevent that from happening. It can intervene in the situation, meaning the Navy and Coast Guard would have every right to intervene in that situation. If the Coast Guard and or the Navy in intervening, no, are themselves subject to some kind of attack or aggressive behavior, then under the MDT, they can call on any nearby U.S. Asset for assistance.
Yeah,
And
because
if
how
they
are
are
we
then attacked,
defining attack? I'm curious, how is the Mutual Defense Treaty defining attack? For example, the use of water cannons, the use of laser lights, is that an attack? If you, let's say, detain Filipino citizens, is that an attack?
The use of force, an illegal use of force, is now what you'll notice is being highlighted by the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command as the applicable standard here. So it's not just an attack using kinetic means, as it's usually called, no? Meaning through the use of conventional weapons like guns. And an illegal use of force can now covers any use of any device that causes injury or damage. So I think that will also be equivalent to an attack, basically, which will engage the Mutual Defense Treaty obligations. In the situation that we've been discussing, what that means is that a Philippine vessel can call on, say, an American vessel nearby for assistance in repelling any kind of attempt to arrest Filipino fishermen and perhaps even cause damage to the Philippine vessels involved. No? And that would be an instance of what the U.S. Calls unit self-defense. It's basically limited to the prerogatives of the vessel or the asset to defend itself from any kind of aggressive behavior. So that, I think, would apply. It does not necessarily result in the declaration of war or the start of World War III, because there's, of course, that there's still an entire escalation ladder, so to speak, between that, between a single incident and outright armed conflict. No, but I think that would be what would be in store. No, it would be a case where a Philippine military or constabulary unit, no, attempting to protect its citizens from an aggressive action, an illegal use of force by another country, and the U.S. would be well within its rights under the treaty to assist. No, and the Philippines would also be well within its rights to seek the assistance of the U.S. in preventing that. No?
Okay.
So that would, however, be limited to that unit. To that incident, no. What happens next depends now on the crisis control mechanisms of the Philippines, no? Or whatever crisis management mechanisms they decide to use, no, after that incident takes place.
Okay. Last week, the Philippine Coast Guard released a video of a China Coast Guard supposedly. This is supposedly preventing the medical evacuation of a sick Philippine Navy personnel stationed in BRP Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal, right? So, in effect, the Philippine Coast Guard says that the Chinese Coast Guard had blocking operations, which made it very difficult to actually move the sick Philippine Navy personnel. The description was harassed by vessels and small boats. So, ang tanong lang naman ganito eh, araw-araw na ganito? Di ba? Ganun yun eh, Professor. Di ba? Yan ang tanong. Araw-araw na tayo bang ganito? O sige, maninindigan tayo, pero araw-araw ganito kahirap? Di ba? Parang ang tanong natin, ilang taong ba to? Ilang taon to na pag nag-resupply ka sa Ayungin Shoal, hihintuin ka? Ilang taon ba to na kapag nag-resupply ka, i-water cannon ka? Because it's a given, we are standing up for it. Well, unless the president, the next president, doesn't do the same thing, right? Because we have to remember, this president has taken a different and more confrontational approach to standing up for the tribunal victory. But who knows with the next president? I mean, all China is waiting for is, let's just wait 6 years. After President Marcos Jr., the next president may not have the same policy as him. That's the problem.
Yes, it is the problem. And yes, araw-araw magiging ganyan, because that is exactly China's intention, to make it so difficult for us that we voluntarily give up and withdraw. Now, the problem with that, of course, is that, yeah, you might have some peace and quiet for a short time, but they're not going to stop there. No. You give them an inch, they'll take the whole arm. Basically, that will be the start of us losing all of our rights and entitlements to the West Philippine Sea. And that will also be the start of us being subjugated, subordinated to China and Chinese power in the region.
Yeah.
So it's for the people to decide now. Is that what they want to happen?
No, I don't believe, I don't think that's debatable, Professor. We're not there anymore. The Philippines, and if you do a survey, the Filipino people want to stand up for the West Philippine Sea. Ang tanong nga lang is, kung araw-araw ito, should we do something out of the box? For example,
yes,
when we resupply in Ayungin Shoal, should we do a test resupply mission where we have Australia assisting us, the U.S. assisting us, just to check if China would behave the same way, right?
Yes, actually. And I do think that certain options, shall we say, of course we can't really reveal all that, but certain options have been considered already. And in a way, we are testing the waters then. No? I would say that, yes, we need to do something else other than just facing the same interference every day. No, Well, adversity breeds ingenuity,
Yeah.
as people like to say, no? So I think that at some point we might see that happening. But of course we have to be prepared for the for that event, no? Everything has to be prepared because definitely the other side will not react kindly to what we do.
So I wanted to ask you, former Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio said the litmus test for President Marcos Jr. is to already start exploration of the Reed Bank. Malaysia started it. We are not yet starting this. There was a moratorium during the time of former President Duterte. Ang tanong, will it make a difference? What message will it send if President Marcos Jr. says, we're starting to explore the Reed Bank?
Well, I think that that would definitely show the determination of the country to assert and exercise its rights in the West Philippine Sea and to really completely ignore this outrageous nine-dash-line claim. So yes, it will be a litmus test of that intention. Reed Bank, after all, is a submerged feature. This is open sea, open water, and it's not something that China can legitimately claim any rights over at this point, given the South China Sea arbitration, no? So if they try to stop us there, then clearly it is going to be another unilateral imposition only of Chinese law in an area which is the Philippines belongs to the Philippines under international law, meaning the resources there belong to the Philippines under international law. So they cannot possibly justify interference there before the international community, and it will only isolate them and alienate them even more, I think. And right now, given their situation, I think that their the margin for tolerating even more distrust from the international community is already very small.
Okay, now, Professor, who is to tell China you cannot impose that law that is illegal in international waters? Who is to say that to China? The Philippines went to ITLOS, right? For the UNCLOS, we want that, but they have no police powers. But when it comes to China, actually, it's not actually just a declaration to us. It is all of ASEAN, right? It's all of ASEAN, not just the Philippines. But who's to tell China? You cannot make a unilateral law.
Ultimately, it's the international community as a whole, no, that can do that. And that's why we continue to build up our relations with all these other countries. And that's why we're also seeing year by year an increasing number of countries calling out China
Excuse me. Go
and
on.
pointing to the South China Sea arbitration and UNCLOS as the prevailing law, no? Admittedly, because China is being obstinate, it will take a long time. It might take decades, no? But I think that's really the only way. In the international community, which is, you know, it's unlike an ordinary community where there is a sovereign, no? Everybody in the international community is equal. So in that sense, it's the community itself as a whole. That's the only one that can really enforce its own rules, no? And it doesn't necessarily have to be through coercion or use of the coercive tactics like a police or a sheriff. It will have to be by making China realize that it's costing it more to be an outlaw, to be an outcast, no? It's making its life even more difficult, no, by doing that, no? And eventually it has to realize that it should play by the same rules as everyone else, and there it should not be a system where one country will lord it over all.
Okay, my last question is, are you giving hope on the ASEAN? I mean, the EU may not be a perfect body, but at the end of the day, for example, the EU has backed Ukraine on territorial issues. You have, I think, one that's abstained, or some nations abstaining from that. But they take a point of view, they take a stand. With ASEAN, we've been silent when it comes to the West Philippine Sea. The code of conduct, we've been waiting for that for so long. Some have said at this point, forget that, that would be a trap. But at the end of the day, you have ASEAN that has not given a point of view on the West Philippine Sea, instead you have ASEAN asking the Philippines not to have foreign intervention with this issue.
Well, I think that ASEAN, no, has its particular purposes, particular uses, no? After all, it was designed in a different time for a very specific purpose of promoting economic relations between such a disparate set of peoples. When it comes to political security issues like this, no, unfortunately, it's not the appropriate body. And as ASEAN gets even larger, we've seen that its ability to make decisions on these kinds of issues is becoming even weaker. No? So I'm not holding out that much hope at this time. No? ASEAN has to mature still, no, on this. That means you have to still keep on working on building up unity within ASEAN first, you engage in the community building. That being said, that means that there is some possibility for less than ASEAN, meaning within ASEAN members, like claimants only. I think that's the one that we need to explore. After all, we saw the unity of the ASEAN claimants back in 1992 when they came up with the declaration, no? It got a little weaker by the 2002 declaration, no? But there's still some hope there, especially now that we see that China's increasing aggressiveness in expansion, no? It will reach a point where even these other countries that have been sort of on the fence, they will realize that the longer term trend here is that after the Philippines, they will be next.
Okay, and just to go back to China's influence, what's happening on the other side of the world? I want to ask you if there's a similarity to it. Not exactly, but we know that Ukraine President Zelensky was in the Philippines and he was talking to President Marcos Jr. about the peace summit. So just recently, EU countries voted, right? I mean, there were several countries that voted on the proposed summit, right? And two countries didn't vote, and they were very crucial countries, Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. They chose not to back the document. And while Russia wasn't invited to that gathering, what's interesting is China, who said to me the main backer of Russia's war economy, didn't attend to and essentially supports it. So at the end of the day, you have China influence on that side of the world and China influence on this side of the world, and also China influence on the African side of the world. So the question is there a similarity with a fact when very powerful nations, because in that side of the world, it was Saudi Arabia and the UAE, who did not vote for that peace summit document, right? One would think who wouldn't vote for such a document, but they didn't. And is it the same with our problem here? Do
Yes,
we have
it's
powerful ASEAN countries who could tip the scale, and yet they're choosing to be silent on China's aggressive behaviors in the South China Sea?
Yes, it's a very similar situation. You still have the power play and the horse trading, etc., between the powerful countries among the small, no? And the key there is for the smaller countries, the middle powers, so to speak, no? To be able to seek the leverage, to find that, find the proper levers, to find the proper balancing between the smaller countries, so that they can generate more resistance, or they could mobilize the support now. And I think that's the task before us now. The thing is, people have to understand that this is not instant decision making. There are many factors at play, and we have to be really careful and strategic in what we do and who we get to support us. And we have to be patient, no? People keep looking for instant solutions. There is none, because this is an international community. These are world politics at play. And so you can't just expect things to change overnight, no? So we have to be the ones to do it. We do have some powerful friends, no? It's not just the US, but there are several others, no? That could play that part of also joining us and tipping the balance with respect to certain countries. The thing there is that we have to be really conscious and deliberate in planning that out, no? It could take years, essentially. But we have to do it. No, there's no other way. Otherwise, we'll just have to give up kung ganon and allow ourselves to be carried away by the decisions of other nations. No, so we just have to keep on doing it.
On that note, thank you so much, Professor Jay Batung Bakal, for joining me today. Thank you, sir.
Welcome, Karen. Welcome, and thank you also.